The ending of the last chapter left us with the revelation that Raijuta had never actually slain anyone before, and with this next chapter, the defeat of Raijuta by Kenshin is at last here. Welcome back everyone to the Wandering Samurai Studying, which we review and analyze every single act told in Rurouni Kenshin. This is chapter 43, Settling the Score. By the end of this chapter, the facade that Raijuta had displayed for the world is completely shattered. He's a shell of the macho giant man that he was originally presented as. In the Secret Life of Characters page, found at the end of this chapter if you're reading the 3-in-1s or on the Shonen Jump app, Watsuki reveals to us that this all came in the way of his exhaustion at the time. As the chapters kept going, Raijuta faded further and further from his vision of who Raijuta was meant to be. A complete opposite of Kenshin. A true believer of Ketsujin Ken, having lived and experienced it himself. Somewhere though, he became more of a fan of the philosophy than a practicer of this belief system. I guess in some ways though, he was the opposite of Kenshin. Kenshin being a man who believes in utter pacifism, despite having soaked his hands in blood, and Raijuta being a believer in soaking your hands in blood and not having actually done it himself. I couldn't call Raijuta a pacifist though, as he inflicted pain on the people around him. Anyway, I highly recommend checking out this page if you hadn't already. However, this raises a question that I'll address after we get into the chapter summary review. It's revealed that the reason Raijuta managed to land a strike on Kenshin is because Kenshin's arm is still under anesthetics from the blow that hit him and Yutaro. Nevertheless, Kenshin promises to defeat Raijuta only using his left hand. Offended by this, Raijuta rushes towards Kenshin, utilizing both of his Izunas for offense and defense, making it difficult for Kenshin to strike Raijuta. However, Kenshin is not in the least discouraged by Raijuta's attack strategy and manages to land a single blow on Raijuta's head, using a single left-handed Batojutsu strike, sending the giant man down. Yahiko makes a running towards Kenshin when he's caught by Raijuta, who attempts to use Yahiko as a hostage. Raijuta's threat is proven empty when even Yahiko calls his bluff to kill him. Raijuta breaks down. His confidence as a swordsman is destroyed. Back at the clinic, Yutaro wakes up to discover that he was not dreaming and he was truly betrayed by the man he called Master. I think that the best part of this chapter is Kenshin pulling a Frieza and promising to end this battle with only one hand. As we know, in Dragon Ball, Frieza ultimately is forced by Goku to actually use whatever body part he promised not to use. Though I do think that this move was an homage to Dragon Ball and getting our hero to make good on his promise the way the space villain broke his. But truly, this handicap for Kenshin was meant to make the chapter a little more interesting to read after having Raijuta exposed as a phony by this point in the story. Having Kenshin defeat him with both hands wouldn't have been nearly as interesting or cool as him using his sword as an arrow and launching a one-handed Batojutsu attack. But Raijuta being a hack did raise a question for me, as to why did this arc drag out so long? We know the meta reason for this, but the in-universe reason is that Kenshin is a pacifist and Raijuta is strong. The difference is that Raijuta hadn't done anything yet to bring about Kenshin's ire until he messed with his own pupil. Kenshin also played a part in preventing everything else, like at the Maekawa Dojo. Now let's get into Raijuta. The big question that's been burning in the back of my head is how Raijuta attempted to kill Maekawa Sensei at the beginning of all of this. As we know, Kenshin stopped this from happening. If Raijuta had never slain before, was he going to just hurt Maekawa before crossing the line of death? Was he planning on breaking some bones or limbs so that he wouldn't hold a sword again? I really want to know. Raijuta taking Yahiko was supposed to be the ultimate last bluff. He figured Kenshin would likely show weakness and try to sucker punch Kenshin, and it didn't work as Kenshin was no longer threatened by Raijuta, having taken him down with his handicap. I think Yahiko is what did it though. Yahiko not showing fear for his life is what destroyed his confidence as a swordsman. The men telling him that if he can't kill Yahiko then he's already lost. The way that Kenshin put it, Sasujin Ken is not about ancient styles or scrolls, it's about the weight of the lives you take in dragging you down to hell. Raijuta's soul was never truly tainted, and don't get me wrong, Raijuta is not a pure soul. This line here actually gives us a rare glimpse into the way Kenshin feels about the lives he's taken. Outside of fighting, he's rather chill and opts to doing house chores before doing anything else, so he doesn't really express his feelings about the lives that he's taken during the war. But here we see that he feels the gravity of his victims. The PTSD of the war and the lives that he's taken are slowly dragging him down to what he describes as hell. Amazing. The final thing that I want to mention is Sanosuke asking about breaking his arm. This is clearly eye for an eye for what he did to Yutaro, but it's also insurance so that he doesn't suddenly feel the need to pick up the sword again. Kenshin doesn't deem this necessary, but this might be Watsuki trying to leave a door open for Raijuta to come back in some shape or form. In the Secret Life of Characters page for Raijuta, he claims, "But this particular guy taught me quite a bit, and I would like to give him some peace in future Ruroken stories." Then again, this guy. All in all, I think Raijuta's biggest mistake is asking the legendary Hitokiri Batosai to dance with him and not knowing how to tango, despite Kenshin repeatedly telling him that he had no interest in dancing. Or, in other words, you mess with the bull, you'll get the horns. This has been chapter 43 of Rurouni Kenshin. What did you think? Let me know down below. If you like this video and you want to see more, then consider subscribing to the channel, give this video a like, and please share this video out to your fellow Ruroken friends. I'd like for this series to get some more eyeballs as we ready ourselves to cover the legendary Kyoto arc. I'll catch you all next time.